It's nice to take you through the sort of equipment that Mick used. If you're not familiar, the guitar he used, his main guitar forever, was a 1968 Les Paul Custom. He actually had the front of the guitar sanded off down to the wood because he basically thought it made the guitar resonate and sound better. But the back and sides were pretty much as normal with black back and sides. He turned me on to something which is going to make some of you laugh. In those days, you couldn't buy a reissue Cream pickup surrounds. And Mick had Cream pickup surrounds. When you could, any place you found Cream pickup surrounds was a 1958 to 60 Les Paul Standard, a Burst, or a Gold Top 57. So you couldn't buy them. So I looked at Mick for these Cream surrounds thinking, wow, how'd you do that? Where'd you get those? And I noticed a couple of weeks later in Melody Maker, after a few weeks, that the actual Cream started to come off and it was black underneath. And I thought, I know what you've done. So I went across the road to the newsagents that sold Airfix models. And I bought a little tin of this Airfix plastic Cream paint and proceeded to paint my surrounds. And sure enough, they look Cream, they look great from a distance. And yes, the Cream did wear off. And every couple of months or so, I'd be sitting after a sound check in the afternoon, my guitar's splayed out, painting my surrounds Cream to get another run of Cream surrounds. This is exactly what Mick did, and it was quite funny. So you got a natural fronted guitar with the Cream surrounds, which he painted on. He took the pick guard off, but it's basically the same guitar as what this is. This is a 1968 Gibson Les Paul Custom first year reintroduction with a two-piece maple top, a one-piece mahogany body with a one-piece mahogany neck, and there's no volute at the back of the neck. No volute. So it's very much the first Les Pauls that Gibson built after they stopped making them in 1960, when the original run stopped and they went on to SG Les Pauls and such like. It's a great guitar. It has attributes of a 50s Les Paul, and I think actually superior, because you haven't got the middle pickup that gets in the way, and you've got genuine middle sounds you don't get from a 50s Les Paul. And you've got a two-piece maple cap on there, which is sort of a la Les Paul Standard, which gives it a lot more cut and thrust, which Mick used definitely to his advantage in a big way. So the guitar's a big part of the sort of Mick Ronson sound. He also used to use an array of Marshalls. Sometimes you'll see him on a JTM and a JTM 45 in early days, and also on recordings. These are that little bit lower output and not so mellow. Sorry, they are very mellow. Sorry, they are lower output and they're very mellow. But later on, what actually happened with Mick, he was using for recording and some stage work, he was using JMP, which this is a Plexi 1967 amplifier, and he had these and the early metal plate versions. He used in 50 watt, which is what this is, and in 100 watt. And most of the time it used to use the basket weave Greenback Celestion cabinet. So what we've done today, we've gone for the lower output version because there was no need to put 100 watts into everyone's head today. I've got the tone from the amp. That's there to show you what you used earlier on. And that's the same cab as the spec he would have used with the same guitar. The other thing that I've got here, which is definitely a major thing in the Mick Ronson sound, is I've got this old Crybaby wah-wah. And Mick used to use the Crybaby wah-wah. He had old Vox wah-wahs, all made by the Gen company. And that's what this is. It's an early one. So in either a Vox case or a Crybaby case, that was the wah, and that was where you got all those very sort of spacey, middly sort of overtone harmonic sounds was all done with the wah-wah. So basically, when you come down to the Mick Ronson phenomenon, a 68 Les Paul Custom, a JMP Marshall with a basket weave cab, and a Crybaby or a Vox wah, I'm afraid I haven't got the blonde wig, the makeup, and the glitter, or the figure to go with it anymore these days. So I've spared you that, because I think if I did turn up like that, I'd be arrested by the fashion police, or possibly even worse. One thing about this guitar I do feel I have to share with you. I bought it many years ago, that's a lot of years, and it come from a country and western guitar player. Don't ask me, Les Paul Custom 68 in 1968 when the guy bought it new, early 69, country and western. And if you notice when you're looking at this guitar, there's lots of little circles all around the edge. There's some on the headstock as well. These are where the guy kindly drilled the front of the guitar in pieces, loads and loads of holes. And he inserted rhinestones into the front, which was sacrilegious. I then took the guitar when I bought it to the late Dick Knight and Gordon, who's still there now, at Knight Guitars, and they filled the holes and resprayed the guitar because it was such a mess when I bought it. But just in case you're wondering why it's got all these raised pieces, that's because it was owned by the Rhinestone Cowboy before I got it. Maybe he should have bought a Telecaster, but never mind. Unfortunately, he bought this. But the good news was, because of the work he had done to it, it made the guitar sufficiently cheap for me to buy it. And here we are, 28 years later, after I bought the guitar, and I've still got it, and it's still here. And we've managed to use it in a way I think even the Rhinestone Cowboy should be proud of. So that's a little bit on the guitar. That's the guitar, you hear the sound, and I hope I've done well enough to at least give you the vibe of what he does. But mainly, don't worry about what I'm doing, trying to sort of put it across. Go and get those two albums and listen to him, because he is well worth a listen. And thank you very much for your listening to me, and I hope everything goes well with what we're doing here, and we put the point across. Take care.